He was, I mean, this guy, if you didn't watch his corner advice on Saturday, you missed out something pretty great. He is a Dutch legend and the coach of Kamaru Usman, the one and only Henry Hooft is here. Hi, Henry. How are you?
How you doing, Luke? I'm good.
It's an honor to get you on the phone here, so we really appreciate your time, Henry. So how did Saturday go from your vantage point? It looked pretty good from ours.
Yes, it was very good. I mean, of course, it's something special to win a belt at the end. But according to training and everything, how the fight went, it was like Kamaru is the last couple of fights, you know, progressing, putting a lot of pressure, doing what he does best, put his will on his opponent. And you saw what happened, kind of broke the opponent and won every round, you know. So, yeah, it was great. As a corner, of course, it wasn't the craziest corner work that we had to do, because he's such a disciplined technically his fight IQ is so high that as a coach you don't really need to do a lot. But at the end of the day, me, Greg, Kami, and the guys, I think we did all good together. We made him good. We prepared him good for the fight, and what he did the last couple of years for his career and now with the belt, that's something that he really did by himself. He's a different guy.
Well, here's what got me fired up, Henry, was right at the end of the break. So right before each next round would start, you would tell him, by the way, and he would be standing and Tyron would be sitting. You would tell him, look at him. Look at him hard. He's sitting, you're standing. Look at him. I got to be honest, that got me fired up sitting on my couch.
And did you stood up or not?
I was fist pumping. I was like, that. I mean, just you could feel the intensity between you and him. You know what I mean?
Yeah. No, it's. I always say it to my guys too. In training, nobody sits down. It's funny. And then when they fight, everybody wants to sit on that little chair. By the way, it's a shitty chair, but you sit down there and then you have to get up there. I think it's much better to just to stand for 15 minutes normally. Now it was 25 minutes. If you can't do that, I think it gives you a little bit of a mental pump. And if you look at the other guy, at least you can see some stuff, especially if you have a fight IQ and or you're a coach or a fighter. He can see that, and he can see that that guy needs to sit down and ask his coach for advice, while our fighter is just breathing, take the water, of course, listens to the advice, but is just doing something that we do in our room for the last couple of years. So I think that's just a normal thing that we do. But the thing that I say, that look at the opponent, it's just a thing that I have from my kickboxing background with all the fighters. We stand in between the rounds. Of course, it's not MMA, so it's a little different. But we stand and we look and we breathe and we can't wait till the next round start. And that's what sometimes gives you a little edge. And if not, you don't need to sit down, man, for 15 minutes or 25 minutes. Come on.
Okay, so let's talk about this. He has said at times that you guys don't have game plans, but there must be some kind of overarching strategy. What was the plan for Tyron Woodley?
I think when we talk about game planning, it's not football, or American football or whatever. I really need to tell you this, Luke. Me, Greg Jones, Kami Barsini, our guys. We have a lot of experience. But we don't overcoach our fighters in the room. We are always in the room, three of our coaches. Of course, we know all the opponents that our guys fighting because we have been doing this for a while. So we kind of know if we fight a wrestler that it's probably a little bit better to have a little more distance. If we fight a striker, whatever. Every aspect of the game, of course, you know when you look at it. But at the end of the day, we are all trainers, not coaches. We are trainers. We want to train our guys, we want to teach them skills so they have enough skills to fight anybody. Nowadays in MMA, everybody gets injured or they pull out of a fight or something happens. And then you've been training for a wrestler and then you're going to fight a striker the other way around. I think overall, you need to work on your skills. And at the end of the day, we are trainers. So we want our guys to have the skills to fight anybody and try to beat everybody with our style of fighting. So, of course, there's a little game plan, but the game plan is in the head of the fighter that's been training like Usman and Michael Johnson and these guys for 7 years. They know our game plan is we come to fight hard. We are offensive, defensive fighters. We have a good guard. We come hard. We go forward. We fight. We make the fight. We tried to finish fights. We put a lot of pressure, but also skills. And I think, especially if you're being a fighter, like I fought myself. I know how it is to have a game plan, and I know everybody says when you get punched in the face, well, in kickboxing when you got kicked in your legs or in your face, the whole game plan changed. But a real fighter knows what to do in the fight, and we are just an extra pair of eyes. We just need to make sure during training camps that they don't get hurt and they're trained the right way. But really, really a big, big game plan, no. Kamaru is a pressure fighter who put his will on his opponents, and that was the whole game plan. That's just what he did, and that means he's been doing that for the last 7 years. So I don't want to be a hater or something, but some coaches, they make themselves too important. It's all about the fighter and the training room, the training partners. And the trainers are there. That's important, but don't put that on the highest platform, you know?
That's interesting. Well, let me push back a little bit if I can. Now, beating Tyron Woodley is an amazing, amazing feat. But what about the argument that, okay, you're right, you need to have this versatile ability because you never know if your opponent's going to change or what they're going to, you know, these things change so often and you have to be well-rounded. That part I can understand. But what about the idea that if you fought someone so good, if you didn't have a game plan, that's just not enough prep? Like if you fought someone like John Jones, I'll be honest, I'm not sure how you beat someone like him without a game plan.
No, well, he's the best fighter of all times for me, so it's very difficult to beat him. But again, I understand what you mean. Of course, there's a game plan, but we just in our gym, we don't look at films with all the coaches, write stuff down and put this stuff on paper. That's other coaches does it that way, and we do it our way. We just train in the mornings and in the evenings with a group of good fighters. With all kind of fighters, kickboxers, wrestlers. I mean, look, we not have one or two UFC guys. We have 14 UFC guys, 9 Bellator guys, 3 Glory fighters, 2 ONE-FC champions. We have so many good fighters that if you can't keep up with these guys, you just lose. If you keep up with these guys, you're going to be good everywhere. And John Jones is something special. Once every many, many years, a guy like that comes very difficult to beat. Everybody gets beaten, but he's very difficult to beat. And I know, because I fought John Jones, not me, but my fighters, Rashad and Vitor. We lost. Is it so bad if you fight 10 times and you win 9 times and you lose to one guy? Is it so bad? No, it's not bad. You just lose to the best fighter there is. So I know what you mean, and I understand there is game plans, but we just work a little different. We just work out 2 times a day. Work on our stuff, make our athletes better, and we really don't care about what the other guys are training for because it's too much thinking, and you never know what's going to happen. So just make sure you're prepared. And Kamaru Usman's cardio is crazy good. That's another big point from him, and that's what we work on, that we can go forward for 5 rounds. That's just really the game plan, you know. And what you said is right. John Jones is the best. It's the best there. He beat everybody. And he's just so good everywhere that it will be very difficult to beat. So I don't think that's a big problem if one guy is better than the rest. And kickboxing, winning or losing, it's a big difference than an MMA. Here you need to have an O record and you need to have need to talk a lot of shit to get stuff done. In kickboxing, we fight each other. And if you lose, you go back to the drawing board, you work on stuff, and you fight each other again later on in your career. If not, so what? But here it's all about, you need to be perfect and this needs to be game planned. No, you just need to fight, be at the best condition you are, and just make sure that you represent your own style, your own identity, without talking trash. Just fight hard and make good fights. That's all there is. That's the way we think about it. So,
fair enough. And your formula is certainly working. I can attest to that. So let's talk about Kamaru here for a second. Couple of things I want to start with him. If I had to ask you, and you've kind of alluded to it here a little bit, but if I could ask you in a more direct way, what makes him so good? What would you say?
Discipline.
What do you mean?
Just discipline in anything, everything he does, from training to family to thinking to everything. Discipline, knowing what he wants, knowing when to do the right stuff, just like in everything, not only in the gym, everywhere. He's a good family man. he's just like the correct guy. And I think he will be a great champion because he's just good, you know, perfect guy to have.
For a guy who is as well-muscled as he is and as skilled a wrestler and now fighter, I don't think I've seen many guys who have his kind of a gas tank. You've been around the fight game a long time, Henry. How rare is that?
Well, it is. You're right. He starts to get better at round 4 and 5. You know, it's just like it's like a diesel. He slowly gets stronger and stronger and stronger, and that's his big plus in the fights. Also, I mean, some guys say, oh, he's not the best striker, and oh, he has not the best wrestling, oh, he has not the best this, but he is disciplined and he has will. And he believes also in the people that are with him. That's also a big thing. He believes in us. He is George Santiago, who started 7 years ago. It's me, it's Greg, all the guys, Rashad, all the guys he was with. We didn't bring special people in. We didn't train with special people. We didn't do that. We have our own people. And that's another big thing that helps him being so good. He has faith in us and his body. But and again, you see, if he takes his shirt out, it's not normal. He's built like he's little Francis, right?
Yeah, he is bricked up.
Yeah. Crazy.
Okay. When did you realize he was not really not? I mean, he came in with a wrestling background and he came in looking like a statue. That's not what I mean. What I mean is, you can see a lot of guys who come from other combative sports and they're not necessarily cut out for MMA. When did you realize that this guy was championship MMA material?
I think after a couple of training sessions, really, because he came with Rashad and he trained with. I remember we talked about it in fight night with Anthony after the fight. Anthony was just chasing around the cage and everything, because Anthony, of course, was already a beast by then. But he always hung in there and he always came back. So we kind of thought, well, you know, it can be something special. And then you need to see him fight. And then he slowly, on the show, on Ultimate Fighter show, you saw him getting better, progressing. And again, back to the training room with so many great fighters here in our place. You saw him compete, getting better with the kickboxers, in striking, and getting also more comfortable in not wrestling during MMA sparring, but just keep standing up to get confident in his striking. And then me again. I do this 34 years now, you know, fighting and coaching of training. You can just see a guy growing and seeing that he is on a certain path with his whole life, with his career in fighting. But also, if you see his television work when he's commentating, he does that very well. You know, he's well spoken, and he does it all very disciplined. So, yeah. But then at the end of the day, they always have to do it in the cage. And the thing is, he does that. Every time when he fought, he showed. He didn't lose. He probably never lost a round. He kept getting better, 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 and better, you know?
Man, it's been amazing to watch. Let me say this. He does have, I mean, look, his numbers, I just went through them at the top of the show. They're literally historic. For his weight class, he has historic numbers in terms of the volume of output and the amount of control. It's amazing. Let me just say this as a minor critique, and I wonder what you make of it. I am merely an observer, so I look to you as the expert here.
Yes.
He has 8 decision wins. Is there an issue with an inability to finish? And I realize I'm asking this after he just won the UFC welterweight title, but if I could nitpick, if I could be petty, is that a criticism?
No, because there's always something, whatever you do, there's always something that people think you're not doing correct, you know? I mean, the same can have been said before by Khabib, who is dominant, you know, that's the same stuff. I think it's not a big thing. First of all, you sign for a 15-minute fight. You train for a 15-minute fight. So that's what you do. And if a knockout or a decision or a submission or a TKO comes, it comes. Everybody wants to win fights before the final bell. But maybe the opponent is good, or maybe you can't stop some guys. And, again, there's always something that people can pick up and say, oh, he's not finishing fights. Or, for instance, now I have a very talented kid in my gym, Shamil Nikaev. I try to get him signed with every organization. I'm not a manager, but I push him always. The kid is 9-0, but he didn't finish people. But the kid has fought Russian top guys only in Russia when he was 19 and 20 years young. So, of course, you don't. But he dominates every fighter. You know, and then they said, but they don't have finishes. Okay, so next time when you sign a fighter, don't sign him for three rounds of 5 minutes, but sign them for finishes, you know? There's some fighters in the UFC who finish fights, but they look horrible. They finish fights, but they got finished also. But these people, they don't finish fights, but they don't get finished themselves too, the durable fighters. So, you know what I mean, Luke? It's,
yep.
There's always something to be said. You know, I see people in the UFC that win fights, and I think to myself, if I see them in the training room, what the hell is going on? But then when they fight in the cage, it's great, and people love it, especially when they start throwing spinning kicks and jumping stuff. People like it. People don't like a simple jab or a good takedown. They don't like that. They want to see jumping stuff, spinning stuff, and everything. So, you know what? At the end of the day, he did what he had to do against a very dominant champion, Tyron Woodley, with a good camp, good people around him, and he dominated. So if people don't like it or people say you have to finish more fights, then step up and do it yourself, right?
Fair enough. Last thing about this, and we appreciate your time, Henry. You know, you've been around the game, as I mentioned, a very long time. You've been with a lot of really successful fighters. You have a fighting background yourself. And, you know, you're around a lot of top guys all the time. Nevertheless, it does feel like this win by Kamaru is really special. I wonder what it means, not just for you, but for the gym, for the guys he's around. This one feels for me on the outside looking in, for whatever that is worth, it feels a little unique.
Well, it's very nice for you, Luke, to say that, because that's another funny thing. Most of the time I get calls from people because some of our fighters is in trouble or whatever, you know. They forget that we have the ONE FC champion, Ong Azong. We have the Bellator champion, Michael Chandler, and now we have Kamaru Usman. We have three champions in three different organizations, you know. Again, like I said before, 14 UFC guys, 9 Bellator guys, kickboxers, and we do it with three coaches and our strength and conditioning coach, Dr. Peacock. So we do it every day. It's not a factory here. People don't go train somewhere else and come to us for a couple of weeks. They live here, they stay here, and they train here. And this win from Kamaru motivates the guys even more, and to see that everything is possible, but it takes time. This is not something you can live, you can get in 6 weeks or in 1 month. It takes a lot of work and a long road. You have to put a lot of miles in there, and most of the guys don't even make it. You know, they don't even make it, but he brings back that belt, and he shows everybody that, yeah, I am here, I'm always working, I'm helping you guys out, and you see what I can do. So it's always a big motivation, but we got three champions, and UFC is always, of course, the biggest name. It's great to have people like that around us, and as the trainers too. These people are good people. Kamaru is a great guy. Michael Chandler is a really good guy. Ong Azong, and then we got Robbie Lawler. We got all the guys around us that are like great. Nick Lance. Everybody's helping each other. We got a good group of people, and there's many more good stuff to come for us, you know. And if it's belt or no belt, one thing they know when they fight out of our group of people is people from our group, they come to fight. Game planning and everything is all nice, but we come to fight. We put pressure and we come to fight, so that's what we work on.
Last question for you. What did you make of the stoppage in Lawler's fight?
How can you stop a guy that's like relentless? The toughest guy there is, one of the toughest fighters, how can you stop a guy like that? I just can't understand that. You know, I know it's difficult because as referees, they need to make split decisions. But a guy like Robbie, you need to give these guys a little more chance. And again, I don't know if he would have won the fight or not. He was beating Ben Askren very bad, of course. But they didn't stop that fight when he was getting molested in the beginning of the fight. And I like that. But then give Robbie a little longer. You know, but you can't change that anymore, you know. We keep that to ourselves. Hopefully they run it back and he gets his chance. But he looked amazing in the beginning of the fight. And another great guy, one of our team captains, you know, Robbie Lawler. So he will be back for sure.
Well, Henry, you guys have so much success. And I don't think, and if anybody was doubting it before, it's no accident. You're a class act and your team is just full of high achievers. Congratulations on yet another one, but I'm certainly sure it's not the last one. And thank you for your time.